Good day, third year students. Today we are going to take a look at one of the major romantic poets of the second generation, and the poet is John Keats. We had already discussed P.B. Shelley and his poem Ode to the West Wind in the earlier classes. John Keats' poem To Autumn is prescribed in our syllabus, and before we take up the poem in detail, let me brief you about Keats' life and career. And then we will move on to the poem. So to begin with, John Keats was born in 1795 in London to a livery stable keeper, and he was the eldest among the four children. For primary education, he was sent to a private school at Enfield, where he became friends with the headmaster's son, Charles Cowden Clarke. Clarke encouraged young Keats to read and study, and there at school, Keats developed an interest in the classics and history. Keats lost his father in an accident at the age of 8, and his mother died of tuberculosis when he was 14, so he had to leave his school and he took an apprentice under a surgeon at Edmonton. After finishing his training, Keats studied medicine at hospital and received his apothecary license, that means a license for a pharmacist. So he received his license in 1816, but he wasn't sure of pursuing a career in medical, as he had always wished to be a poet, not a doctor. So before the end of 1816, he made his mind to follow his dream and his dream to become a poet, and gave up his medical career. And then Keats met Leigh Hunt, who was a poet and essayist, in 1816, who recognized his talent, and he agreed to publish his works and helped him to begin his poetic career. Leigh Hunt also introduced him to some great literary figures of the times, such as Charles Lamb, Shelley, and William Hazlitt. The years of 1818 to 1819 were the most productive years of Keats' career as a poet. He wrote during this time Endymion, La Belle Dame Sans Merci, Lamia, Hyperion, and The Eve of St. Agnes. But Keats earned his place among the great romantic poets of English literature because of his odes that he wrote in 1819. And these are Ode on a Grecian Urn, Ode on Melancholy, Ode to a Nightingale, Ode to Psyche, Ode on Indolence, and To Autumn. And it is said of him that if he wrote only these six odes and hadn't written anything else, even then his contribution to English literature would have still been the same. But ironically enough, when he was doing professionally so well, he was suffering personally. His brother died of tuberculosis in 1818, with whom he was so attached. Keats himself contracted the same disease, possibly when he was taking care of his brother. His health was declining day by day, and by the year 1820, he was critically ill. He was also running short of his money, and all these problems became an obstacle in his marriage with Fanny Brawne. Fanny Brawne was the girl he loved so much. But they couldn't marry each other. When his health was getting worse with the disease, he was advised by his doctors to move to a warmer climate. So he left for Italy with a friend, and he died in Rome at the age of 25. And out of 25 years, his writing career was only of 4 to 5 years only. But even in this short period, he could write so much, and so he could write so good that he is now one of the most studied and most admired British poets. Now let's talk about his poetic style and main features of his poetry. First and foremost, his love for nature. Like the other romantic poets, he also admired and appreciated nature in his poems. Love for beauty, and his love for nature arises from its beauty. He does not see any spirituality like Wordsworth sees in nature. He rather admires nature for its physical beauty and physical objects. To him, as he also stated in the opening lines of Endymion in his poem, "A thing of beauty is a joy forever." And in the famous Grecian ode, he says, "Beauty is truth, truth beauty, that is all. Ye know on earth and all ye need to know." And when he describes beauty, it is highly sensuous. That means it appeals to our five senses of touch, sight, smell, hear, and taste. He is the most sensuous poet among the romantics, and this characteristic is most notable in his odes. There are pictures, sensuous pictures that appeals to our imagination. For example, his poem "To Autumn" is a painting in words, and the way he describes season's beauty, it evokes a clear picture in our mind. Next, medievalism. Just like Coleridge, Keats also had a fascination for Middle Ages and romances, and his poems like "The Eve of St. Agnes" and "The La Belle Dame Sans Merci" have medieval elements and atmosphere of the Middle Ages. Next is Hellenism. Hellenism, the word is derived from Greek word Helen, so Hellenism means Greek quality. Keats gives references and allusions of Greek literature, culture and art in his poems, about which he came to know after reading translations of Greek classics and studying about Greek sculpture and art. His ode on a Grecian urn and his poem on first looking into Chapman's Homer shows his love and fondness for the Greek art and literature. And lastly, his poems has lyrical quality, especially his odes. His odes are known for their sheer music. Sensual imagery, use of alliteration and diction all work together to create rhythm and music in his poems. Now let's have a brief introduction of the poem "To Autumn" that we will be studying in further classes. The poem was composed on September 1819 and it got published in 1820 with other poems. And this is one of the final poems in the group of famous 1819 odes. And Keats talked about the influence of the scene which made him to write this poem. In a letter to his friend, he wrote, "How beautiful the season is now, how fine the air, a temperate sharpness about it. I never liked stubble fields so much as now. Somehow a stubble plain looks warm in the same way that some pictures look warm. This struck me so much in my Sunday's walk that I composed upon it." So it is evident in these lines how he was struck by the unique beauty of the autumn season, that he felt compelled to write a poem on it. And the poem has three stanzas, and Keats in just three stanzas paints a beautiful and unique picture of the season with different aspects of it. In the first stanza, Otam is presented as a conspirator working with the sun to bring the fruits to a state of perfect ripeness. In the second stanza, Otam is a thresher sitting on a granary floor, then a reaper asleep in a grain field, a gleaner crossing a brook, and a cider maker. In the final stanza, Keats compares autumn's music with the music of spring. The music which autumn produces is as pleasant as the music of spring, and one can find autumn's music in the sound of nets, lambs, crickets, and in the sound of birds, robins and swallows. So this was this so much about the poet and the poem To Autumn. I will take up the poem in detail in the further classes. Thank you so much for listening.